Let us start with the session today. And this session is very, very important session because a lot of new things we are going to learn today in this session. The last day, what we did, we have learned about dictionaries. And we have learned about dictionaries in detail, right? What is it? How it is written? What is the importance about dictionary? And there is a point, the keys of a dictionary must be of immutable type. The last point is there, the keys of the dictionary must be of immutable type. It should not be mutable data types. Always a key will be immutable. It can never be mutable objects. Here it is. These were the two questions given to you last day. So now let me show you how to solve the question. The first problem was write a Python script to check whether a given key is existing in a dictionary or not. So I will go to a new file. In the new file, I will just create. The question is to check whether a key exists in a dictionary or not, right? So first we have to create a dictionary. D is equal to something like this. As we have seen last day, that a dictionary is created within the opening and closing braces. And then I will write something like this. And then what I have to do is I will just find out whether this D is having any element, any particular key or not, right? So since the keys here are integers, so you have asked the integer input from user, enter a key to search, to be searched. Since dictionary is a sequence, we can use in operator with dictionaries, isn't it? So let us find out, let us write the code here. So if v in d, most of you have written like this, if v in d, if the v key is in the dictionary, better we name it as key or k, whatever. Better to name v as key. If key in d, just print it is present. Otherwise, else you say print not present, right? And let us execute the code and see what is the result. Enter the key to be searched. So we have how many keys? In the problem, we have three keys. As you can see here, we have 1, 2, and 3, right? So let me search for 3, and it is saying that it is present, right? So the code works. Now if I'm executing the code again and I'm searching for 45, a key 45, it is giving us not present. Okay, so work is over. So this much to search for a key, if it is present in the dictionary or not, whether it is there in the dictionary or not. The other solution for this is you can use a function called get, and that we have not learned till now, but we will see it today. So that get function you can apply here, and you can write like print d dot get key comma it is not present, something like this. This much you don't have to write, just write 3 lines. The first line is declaration of dictionary, the second line is key, inputting a key, and the third line is just to call get with these two parameters. The first parameter is the key to be searched, and the second parameter is that word or that sentence or that value which is to be returned if the key is not found. Okay, if the key is found, the key will be returned, otherwise it will return it is not present. So just I'm executing the code here, and we have, say for example, I want to search for 3, it is giving us 3. Okay, correct hai. But now if I am going to execute it and I am going to put 45, 46, it is giving us it is not present, right? So this way also, this is another way of doing the same thing using get function. Now let us go for the next question in the example exercise. And that question was, write a Python script to generate and print a dictionary that contains a number between 1 and n in the form of x, comma, x square. Okay. So this problem can be done very easily. Let us see how this problem can be done. So creating a dictionary between 1 to n where elements are x comma x square, right? So this can be done using a list comprehension and use of dictionary dict function. We have seen a conversion function called dict which converts a list or sequence into dictionary if it is possible. So let us find out how to do it. So we can go through a loop, or we can directly go through a dictionary. We can create like this: d is equal to dict of, inside this dict function I have to create a list which will contain list of tuples, and each tuple will have x and x into x. So what to do? It's quite easy to do. Just create a list and here write the list comprehension form. The list comprehension form will be x comma x square, right? For x in range 1 to n plus 1, right? But here I have not mentioned what is n, so I have to input n from the user. So input the value of n, right? That has to be asked from user. So this will work, and then you just print d. That's it. These three lines will do for you. Let us execute the code. So here it is, input the value of n, and I am inputting the value as 15. And you see, here we go. It has created a dictionary with values 1 colon 1, 2 colon 4, 3 colon 9. And that's what was needed. This is what was needed with each natural numbers between 1 to n. I had to create a dictionary with that natural number as key, natural number as key, and natural number raised to power in natural number as value. Today, the first topic that we are going to learn is iterating dictionary, right? Now, what do you mean by iteration? Iteration means repeating, right? Repeating elements present within a dictionary, right? So if we want to repeat items within a dictionary, we want to repeat or iterate through each item within the dictionary, that will be called as iterating the dictionary. So if we visit each and every item within a dictionary, or if we visit each and every key value pair within a dictionary, we can call it as traversing dictionary or iterating through dictionary. So we can iterate through dictionary. As you can see, there is a very good syntax over here. As you can observe, dict d key some value. So this is the syntax that you should use for accessing each element inside a dictionary. So what you have to do, you have to start with a for loop and iterate each key within the dictionary by writing for key in the dictionary name colon, and then within that dictionary access that key which is being iterated. The key, since the keys are being iterated one after another, you will just write that key name with the dictionary giving a square bracket, and hence it will access each element of the dictionary. That means each value, it is responding to each value of the iterated key. Whatever key is being found in the loop, whatever key the loop goes through, it will be giving the value of that key. This expression will give the value of that key. So I hope this expression is very clear to you. you should note down this one, that if you are going to iterate through a dictionary, you should write something like this, where you have to iterate a variable through the dictionary, right, by writing for key in dictionary D colon, and then you should use this type of syntax to access the element. Let us find out the example code related to this syntax. We will use this syntax to iterate through each element of the dictionary. Now I'm going to declare our dictionary here only in the interactive mode. I am going to declare the dictionary. And why to write a dictionary when there is one for us, right? Let us copy and paste this dictionary only. D is equal to something like this. And now what I will do, I will iterate through each and every element in this dictionary using the same syntax. And the syntax was very quite easy syntax. I'm just writing the syntax here only for key in dictionary. Okay. And then dictionary at key is equal to something, right? This was to be used here. So let us use this syntax and find out whether we can write the things correctly or not. Okay. So for key in capital D, our dictionary here is capital D, this one. Okay. So for key in capital D colon, and then we have inside it, I will print the value, print D at K, and it will give us all the values within the dictionary, one after another. If you want, you can place here end, and you can just use any character to end that particular between those keys. You can write anything. Say, for example, if you want to use this pipe character, right? If you want to use this pipe character, you can use it. Now you see what happened. It has printed all the values with a pipe character, right? It has shown this output where it is ending all the values with a pipe character. So the first value in the key was 1. So 1 is printed. The next value with the key 2 is 4. The 4 is printed. The next value with the key 3 is 9. So 9 is printed. The next value with key value 4 is 16. So 16 is printed, and so on. And the last value was with the key 15. It is 225. Now suppose that if I want to print the keys also with the values. So I can write like this, print, and in the bracket I will write dk, or I can write simply k with this pipe character. Say, for example, pipe character, and with it I will just simply mind this thing, and with this I will do what? I will write here k comma dk, this tuple will be printed, and here I will write end is equal to comma. Now you see what will happen. So we have a print statement, within it I am printing this thing. So see here what is being given. It is giving all the keys with values as a tuple, right? And it is printing it separated by a comma. So this shows us how to iterate through a dictionary elements using a loop. As you have used for loop here, you can use also while loop, no problem, no issue with that. You can use while loop, but we have a convenience with for loop, right? Because a for loop always iterates through the sequence automatically. You don't have to set anything. Okay, just pass the sequence and iterate a variable. It will iterate from the first element to the last element automatically. So there is a convenience lying with for loop, though we can do it with while loop too. Now our next topic of discussion is built-in dictionary function, and we will see many of the functions which were already there with lists and tuples, right? Here in case of dictionaries too, we will have the same type of many of the functions are repeated here, those we have seen with lists and tuples, right? But dictionaries have their own set of functions. So let us find out what are the new functions related to dictionaries. So the first function over here is CMP dict 1, dict 2. As I have told you that this function is applicable only to the version 2.x of Python. No longer is it is applicable with 3 onwards. So what it does, it compares two dictionaries, returns 1, 0 and minus 1. Having sum of values. It is based on calculating the sum of values of both the dictionaries. Whosoever is having higher value, that minus the lower value, the difference will come. Say for example, if dict 1 has a sum higher to that of dict 2 values, then plus 1 will be returned. If dict 2 values have altogether sum greater than that of dict 1 values, negative value will come, minus 1 will come. If dict 1 and dict 2 have both same sum of values, then 0 will come. Now let us go for the next function, which is very important here. And that function is length of the dictionary. As you know that len is a, these all functions are what? They are global functions of Python. They are not part and parcel of any special object, and they can be applicable to each and every sequence, whether it be list or dictionary or tuples, right? So length len function is applicable to dictionary too, and it calculates out the total number of elements present in a dictionary, right? Now str of dict, there is a function called str of dict, and you can use this str of dict function to change or to convert a dictionary into corresponding string. It can convert a dictionary into corresponding string, right? Now let us go for the type function. And the type functions, as I have told you earlier in the class, I have gone through that example. When we apply type function on dictionary, it gives us the type as dict. Now we have clear function, which is also there. Fifth function is the clear function. And this clear function gives us what? Power to clear all the elements from dictionary. It just removes all the elements from the dictionary so that it empties the dictionary. There is no element left over in the dictionary. So what we get? An empty dictionary. And the last one is copy, which is a shallow copy. And in case of dictionary, the dictionary as a whole is a mutable object, because the elements in the dictionary can be taken out, removed, they can be added on, etc. But the key part of each element is immutable. Remember that. So copy function, what is the purpose of copy function? The copy function shallow copies one dictionary to other. Shallow copying means they will not share the same memory location. They will be created on different memory addresses, as I have told you in case of lists. Here the dictionary is mutable data type, and hence when we assign one dictionary to another dictionary by writing this thing, say for example d1 is a one dictionary and I write d1 is equal to d2, that means I want to create d1 using d2. By assigning d2 to d1, what will happen? Both d1 and d2 will share the same memory address, as you can see on the screen. They will share the same memory location. That means any changes made in d2 will be reflected on d1 and vice versa. But when you are going to, this is simple assignment, but when you are going to shallow copy it, now what do you mean by shallow copying? By writing this thing, d1 is equal to copy function will be called, and you pass here d2. So when you are copying this d2 into d1, what will happen? This shallow copy will be created. That means there was already a d2. Now d1 will be also created separately in separate memory. D1 will be created in this second case. D1 will be freshly created, and whatever content of d2 was there gets copied into d1, but their locations are two different locations. Whereas in this case, in first case, they were having same location. They were having same location, right? But here in the second case, the copy mechanism creates two distinct memory locations. Now let us go to practice this six functions first, and then we will go proceed with the other set of functions, right? I will not go into the details of CMP because we have seen already, right, in the last class with length, with lists and all that. You will follow the same syntax as followed in the list. I will just execute length, str, type, clear and copy. These three functions I will, five functions I will execute. Okay, the first function was CMP, right? Let us just do it. CMP, I will create D1, and this is having 1:1, 2:4, and then 3:6, and I have another dictionary D2 which is having 1:3, and then 2:4, 3:6, right? And then I'm going to compare CMP with D1, D2. What it should give us? Let us find out what it will give us if I'm writing CMP D1, D2. In this case, it will give us error because we are using which version of the Python? 3.8. It is applicable on 3.2. So let us start the idle 2.7 and see what it gives. So let me copy and paste the code over here in this idle so that it is easily being shown to you. So here we have these three lines copied into 2.7. Now you see it has turned to violet. The function CMP has turned to violet, right? So now we can execute this. It is giving us -1. Just calculate the sum of values of two dictionaries. Find out. Just calculate out what is the sum of the values of D1 and what is the sum of values of D2. Values means the value part, not the key. Only the value part. Whose value is higher? D1 or D2? Whose sum of values is higher? It is higher with D2. Here the sum of values will be 1+4+6, that is 11. And here it will be 3+4+6, and that is 13. So this is greater, the second one is greater, D2 is greater, and hence it is coming as -1. What if I am writing CMP D2 comma D1, what it will give us? Yeah, it will give us +1, correct, because here the D2 will become higher than D1. So positive value minus means higher value minus lesser value will give you positive value. That is why +1. What if I am going to change D2 as, if I am going to change D2 as 1:1, right? And then I will write 2:4, 3:6, isn't it? Now if I'm going to compare CMP D1 with D2, what it will give us? Now it will give us 0 because both of them have become equal. The second function in the series was, let us find out, the second function was length. So apply length over D1. Let us apply length over D1. And see what it gives us. Length over D1, and it gives us 3 because there are 3 elements in the given dictionary D1, right? So length is okay. Then max over D1 will give you maximum value of, it will give us the maximum value of D1. The maximum, which value it is giving, the key value or the value? It is giving max of D1 means it is giving the maximum key value, not the value, but the key value. It is giving the maximum value of the key rather than the value, right? Mean of D2 will give you the minimum of the key, that is 1, right? And hence you can understand that max and min functions are acting over key, not values. Okay, please note it down. Now here we have str, the third function here is str. So we, since we I have shown you length, I have also shown you max and min, because max and min are there, which can be applied on dictionary too, but it is applicable on the keys only, right? Now let us come to str, converting a dictionary to a string. So a dictionary can be converted to a string simply by writing str of d1. It gives you the string format of a dictionary. So you can convert simply a whole dictionary into a single string and just go with it. Whatever you want to like, you want to do with this string, you can do, right? Next is type. So type, when applied on d1, will give you the class of that data type, and the data object is of class dict, dict. That means it is a dictionary. D1 is a dictionary. Then we have clear. By writing clear of d1, we can clear d1. So now here again, the name clear is not defined, so it is not a global function of Python. It is member function of dictionary or sequence rather. So you have to write like d1 dot clear, rather writing clear and inside parameter d1. See the difference between this syntax and this syntax. Observe the difference between these two syntaxes. Sometimes they are also called as functions and methods. This is called as function and this is called methods. In some book it is mentioned these are functions and these are methods. When we call it using this function, this type of syntax, it is called methods, right? But altogether, remember that functions or this type of functions are global functions. They are present in the Python core library or the global libraries, not inside any data object. But here the clear is inside d1 data object, and hence when you are going to press d1 dot clear, it will give you, it will clear the d1 only, it will clear the d1 variable. Now what is d1? It is a dictionary. Let us now print the d1 and see what are there. So you can see here it is giving you empty dictionary, since d1 is now what, it is a empty dictionary. The elements have been removed. Now next function is copy function. As I have told you, copy is one function. For that you have to import a package called copy. So copy, and then you have to do what? You have to write here. Now you can write d3 is equal to copy d2. Now here the error is there, so we have to write the whole thing. D3 copy dot copy and d2. Okay, now it is okay. Now you see what is d3. D3 is our new dictionary which has been copied from d2. Now you see it has the same content as that of d2. Whatever was the content of d2, the same content has gone to d3. Now let us check whether the shallow copying has happened or not. Let us find out by observing their memory address. So how to find the memory address of a variable in Python? By writing id, by using id function, right? So id of d3, let us find out id of d3 and comma id of d2. Let us find out whether they are equal, same or different. Now as you can see that they are both different. As I've told you that they will be in concept of shallow copying, two different memory addresses or locations will be created, isn't it? So this, there is a difference between memory address of d3 and d2. Okay, now let us find out if I am going to simply assign without using shallow copying copy function, if I am going to assign d3. So say for example I am going to make a d4 and equate it with d3, what will happen? See, d4 will be having same value as that of d3, but this is not shallow copying, this is simple memory copy. This is a simple memory copy. What do you mean by memory copy? Let us find out with the id. I will now find out the id of d3 and d4. Let us find out whether they have same id or they have created a different id. Now you can see, so d4 is having same address, so the same thing holds good for shallow copying. Here in case of dictionary, the same as we have done in list, the same thing is goes over here. That means for shallow copying we are using copy function, and for a simple memory wise copying we are using what? We are using equal to operator. Now let us go for the next function, next set of functions actually. So we have built-in dictionary functions continued, and these are important functions which are very much related to dictionaries. These functions are only and only related to dictionaries. Remember, these functions you have not found in lists or tuples, right? These are the explicit functions which are only and only related to dictionaries. So we have the first function over here, and that function is items, right? We have a function called items. So items is a function which returns you the it returns a list of all items or key value pairs, tuple pairs of present in the dictionary in the form of tuple, right? So what items does, it gives you, it returns you a list of tuples. Each tuple will have key value pair of dictionaries, right? The whole dictionary, whatever key value pair is there, that will be returned as a list of tuples. Then we have keys. Keys function, what is the purpose of keys function? It returns a list of dictionary keys. So what it will return? It will collect all the keys from every key value pair and return it as a list. So it will create a list of keys from the dictionary and return it. Similarly, we have a function called values. Here I have not written it. So you can have values also. So key is there, and there is something called values. Please note it down. Values, which gives you, returns you the values of all the things, right? It gives you list of values present in our dictionary. Okay. Then we have get function. What is the purpose of get function? Now the get function, the get function is having two parameters, right? The first function, the first parameter is the key. That means you are passing the key for which you want the value. You want to get a value for a key. So you are passing that key. If that key is present in the list, in the dictionary, the value corresponding to that key will be returned. Okay. Now, if that value is not present, in the dictionary, then whatever you pass as second parameter will be returned. And since the second parameter, as you can see in the syntax, I have given a square bracket. What is the meaning of this square bracket over here? That means the second parameter is optional. You may or may not pass second parameter at all. If you are not passing the second parameter at all, what will happen? It will return none in case the key does not exist in the dictionary. So there are three possibilities. First possibility, if the key is there in the dictionary, it returns the value for that key. If the key is not in the dictionary and you have passed the second parameter, then the second parameter will be returned. The third case is, if the key is not present in the dictionary and you have not passed the second parameter, then none will be returned. The data type none will be returned. You know that none is also a type of keyword in Python which returns none value. So none will be returned. Now the next function, the 10th one, the 10th function here is set default key. And the set default key, what it gives? It gives key, comma, default is equal to none. Now you see here, what do you mean by set default key? What is the purpose of set default key? Just find it out. On the right side, it is explained. What it does, returns value of the key if it is in the dictionary. Returns none if the key is not in the dictionary. Returns default value if key is not in the dictionary and default value is specified. So what it does, it is similar to get. Set default is also doing similar to get, but there is one difference. Here the word set is used instead of get. Set is used. Set means to fill the value if it is not present. That means what? If the key is not present in the dictionary, it returns none. The default value is none, it will be returned. Returns the default value if the key is not in the dictionary and default value is specified. If the default value is specified, it returns the default value. And if if the key is not present in the dictionary, if the key is not present in the dictionary and the default value is specified, then it will create the key. It will create the key in the dictionary. So this is a very important difference. We'll see that while executing the code. Okay. So let us execute these four functions first, and then we will go for the next set of functions, right? Now, the first function in the series was items, right? Here it is. So we have a dictionary. Now, if I'm writing d1 dot, now since these functions, whatever four functions we have learnt right now, all of them are member functions of dictionary object. So they will be accessed using dot operator. So d1 dot get, the first function was items, right? So d1 dot items, it gives you the list of, d1 dot items gives you a list. It returns your list. Since it returns your list, it is iterable. That means you can use this expression in a for loop to iterate with one of, to iterate through each one of them. You can just use it in for loop. Let us use it in for loop for x in d1 dot items, right? And then you are printing print x at 0 plus x at 1. Or I can say that you can write like this. You can simply write as x sum of x at sum of x, right? Sum of x, and then comma end is equal to, so you can see here the output is 269. What it is doing, it is iterating through each one of them, and it is getting the sum of key and value. It is printing the sum of each element, and it is made up of key and value element. So each key and value will be added and it will be shown. So it is a program to show the sum of key and value. It is of a dictionary, right? So let us go to the next function. The next function is keys. So what it will give you, d1 dot keys. Let us find out what it gives us. It gives us a list of dictionary keys. And the list is returned with having all the keys in the dictionary. What were the keys in the dictionary? In our case, d1 is having keys as d1, 2, 3. These were the keys in our dictionary d1. So all those keys are being returned here. And here, so 1, 2, 3 is being returned as a key value. Now, since it is a list like the previous items function, it is returning a list, so they are iterable. So what to write for I in d1 dot keys, you can write like this, and then you can do anything with I. Okay, so you can do what, you can just simply write print I into 4. So 4, 8 and 12 is the answer, correct? Let us come to the next question, next function actually. So the next function in the series is values. As I've told you that along with keys, we have values also. So let me write it values. So values function, how this will act. D1 dot values. Let us find out what it gives. It gives us dictionary values. That means D1 dot keys were returning what? It were returning the set of all keys. And D1 dot values, what it returns? It returns set of all values. That is 1, 4 and 6. So it is returning 1, 4 and 6, and since it is a list, it is also iterable. You can use it in for loop. So for I in d1 dot values, you can just simply write like this and iterate it, and you can just print okay I star star I, okay? So what will be the output? It is giving what? 1, 2, 56 and 4, 6, 6, 5, 6. How this is coming? There are two stars. Two star means raised to the power of. I raised to the power of I. So 1 raised yes, to the sir. Power of 1 is 1. 4 raised to the power of 4 is 256. 6 raised to the power of 6 is something 46656. Okay. So this is how it goes on. Now let us go for the next function in the series. And the next function is get function. This is very, 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 very important function as far as list is dictionary is concerned. So let us reassign this dictionary so that it is visible to you. And I will add one more element in it. Say this one. Okay. So now what I will do, I will write here d1.get. Now I will use all the different versions of get. Just see it, observe it, whether you can find it good or not. So I will write here d1.get. If I'm writing like simply like this, what will happen? It will give error because get is a function which should be passed a parameter, which should be passed with a single parameter at least. At least one parameter is required. Type error, it at least accepts one argument. Got zero. You have supplied zero. So you should give here d1.get and you should pass here the key. The get function returns you the value of that key which is passed as argument. So I want to find out what is the value of the key 5. So I will pass here 5. Now see what will happen. What will happen? It is giving us 8. The value of 5 is 8. The key is 5. The value is 8. The value of the key 5 is returned. Now see here d1.get. And if I am writing 15, I want the value of that key whose key value is 15. What will be the output? It will give you nothing. It is not giving you nothing. So d1.get 15 will return you nothing. It is not returning anything. Let us print it. Let us print it. Let us print d1.get 15. It is printing you none. That means it is returning what? None. You are not finding the key in the list. Sorry, in the dictionary. The value returned will be none. But there is one more version of get where we pass two parameters. So we write here d1.get 15 and then I can write here key not found. Now I am passing what? The second parameter. If I were not passing second parameter, it is giving us none. But if I am passing that second parameter, it gives us that parameter if the key is not found. But this will not be the same case when the key will be found. Say for example, if I am going to paste this line and pass it here 10 instead of 15, I am passing 10. Now 10 exists in the set of dictionary, right? The key 10 is existing there. Now if you are going to press enter, you will get what? 2, the corresponding value. You will not found key not found. Okay, so this is how the get function behaves. Now let us go to the set default. Set default, what you are going to pass key and the default value. So here I will write here d1.set default. Okay, and now I will pass here 15 and let us find out what it gives us. It gives us nothing. If I am writing print d1, if I am now going to print d1, what it is showing us. Now you see how the get is different from set default. How get is different from set default, just you see here. What difference you find?
In that default
has created a key if it is not found with none value. If you are not passing that value, then none value will be added to that value. That key's value will be none. If I'm writing set default and here I'm passing 17, which is not there in the dictionary, as well as I'm passing here, if I'm passing here 23, then what will happen? What will happen? It will search for the key value 17. If the key value is found in the list, if the key is found in the list, the corresponding value will be returned. But if the key is not found in the list, and since we have passed the second parameter as 23, a key value pair 1723 will be created. And that is what the case is. And it returns that value. Whatever new value you have set to 17 has been returned. And then you just print d1 and see what happens. Now you have a new key value pair here, 1723. So this is the difference between the way of execution of get and set default. So both are actually giving you the value to a corresponding key, but set default creates a new key if it is not found with a value. Is it okay? So now let us go to the next set of library functions in this series. So here it is. The 11th function is pop function. And here there is one parameter that you must have to pass, and that parameter is the key. So pop function removes the key and returns it. There is no remove function here in the dictionary. There's no such remove function. There's only one function to remove items from dictionary, and that is pop. Remember, when we were using these functions, get and set default function, it does not remove the key. Though it returns you the value of that key, but it does not remove the key from the list, from the dictionary. The key still remains in the dictionary. It is not making any changes in the dictionary. But here, the pop function, it returns and removes the value found for that particular key, if it is existing. If not found, then whatever will be passed as default will be returned. Whatever will be passed as second parameter will be returned. And if the second parameter, that is default, is not mentioned, if that is not mentioned, returns key error. If this default value is not mentioned and the key is not found, then it returns. In case of get and set default, it was returning none. But here it will not return none. It will return you key error. Remember, it will return you key error because it has to be deleted, and hence the key error will come. Right? So this is one thing. Next is pop item. So you have to pass here, you remember that with pop you have to pass key and other parameter, which is default parameter. If this key is not found, then this is returned, and if this is not being passed, then a key error will be generated. So always pass the second parameter. It is advisable to pass the second parameter so that the key error is not generated. If the key is not found, then this second parameter will be given to you. The next is pop item. What is the difference between pop item and pop? Pop item also selects and remove a particular key value pair from the dictionary, but it does it randomly. It does it randomly, not in a particular order, but not in a particular, because you are not mentioning any key here. See the syntax over here. You don't have to mention any key here. Okay, no key is being mentioned inside the parameter. Only you have to write pop item, that's it. And it will pop out any item key value from the dictionary, from anywhere, randomly. Arbitrary, it chooses a key value and returns you. This will be very much important when you are going to program a game program or something like that, where you want to randomly choose a key value pair from the dictionary and remove it, and also want to remove it. Once it is used, remove it. That's what is the point here, right? Now the next function here is from keys, and this is very, very important function. You are going to pass a list of keys, and from that keys it will automatically create a key value pair. From keys you are passing a set of a sequence. A sequence means it can be a list, it can be a dictionary, it can be a dictionary, or it can be a tuple. Whatever you are going to pass, it will create a dictionary taking all the values inside the past sequence as key, and all the value will be set to none. And next is update function, and this is very, 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 very important function. What is this update function? You can update a dictionary with a new set of key value pair by passing it as a parameter, and that key value pair can be passed as a sequence, it can be passed as a list, but it should have dual elements. Right, it should have a dual elements. The size of the each item must be of this sequence must be 2. The length of each item of this sequence must be 2, so that a key value is generated and the corresponding list is updated, dictionary is updated. Okay, so it updates the existing dictionary with new values, new key values. Okay, so this is what how it acts. Now let us execute these four functions and see how this acts. The first function in the list was pop. the pop was the first function. Let us pop out. Let us create a dictionary first. 6. Okay. Now you can see here the value 12 is repeated. We can repeat the values, no problem. The only problem is that there cannot be repeated keys, but by values can be repeated for keys, no problem, no issue with that. The keys are immutable, so they cannot be repeated, but the values can be repeated. Two keys can have same value, no problem, no issue with that. Now if my dictionary D is this one, let us apply the functions. The first function is pop. So what I will write, D dot pop, again you have to use dot notation, so D dot pop, and here I will pass 6 as key. I am passing 6 as key. What it gives us? The value for this. So it returns me the value for this key 23, as well as it removes it. That means no longer this value will be there. This key value pair will be removed from the dictionary. Let us find out whether it has been removed or not. So what to do? Just print D and find it out whether 623 is there or not. So nowhere it is found, so it has been removed. Okay, so this is how the popped act. Now if I'm writing D dot pop and I'm passing that key which is not in the list, then what will happen? Say I am passing pop 90 and this 90 key is not there in the list. It gives you key error. Remember, this generates a key error because you have not passed the second parameter here. Since you have not mentioned the second parameter with pop, it returns you a key error. But what if you are writing D dot pop and with 90 you are mentioning key not found, then you see this is quite good option to use. Now it will give you, not give you error, it will give you key not found. So this is a beautiful thing about pop function, right? Now let us go for the next function, which is pop item. Which is pop item. So we have how many items remaining in our dictionary? We have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5 items are there in the dictionary. Let us pop 2 items one after another using pop item. So D dot pop item, and I will not pass anything, because if you are going to pass anything, it will give you error, because pop item does not takes any argument. You see here, it gives you pop item, does not takes, it takes no argument. So you should not pass any argument to pop item. So what to do? D dot pop item, and here you don't have to pass any argument. It arbitrarily chooses item from the dictionary and removes it. So let us find out what it arbitrarily chooses from the list, from the dictionary, given dictionary. So this is our dictionary. You can see our dictionary at the top. It has 5 elements now. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Let us execute this pop item. Now you see it has given you the key value pair. It is returning you the key value pair. So pop item does not return, sorry, only value. As in the case of pop. What pop was returning? It was returning only the value, not the key. You have passed key, it has returned value. But here in this case of pop item, what it is returning? Key value pair as a tuple. And it removes it from the list. No longer this 2 and 6 will be available there. And from where it is removed? Key value pair from the last end, rear end. But it is not the case always. It can remove the tuple, the key value pair from anywhere, any position. Let us find out. Let us execute again. D dot pop item. Now you see 324. Again, it has taken out from the rear end, right? Let us again execute pop item. 890. Again, it is from the rear end only, right? D dot pop item. 512, again from the rear end only. D dot pop item. 12. Now what happened? Wow, what happened in this case? Till this point, how many items were there? 2 items. Out of them, which one is been popped out? The first one, 12, not the rear end. 512 was the rear end item. It is not being removed. Only 1 and 12 is removed, right? So this is the case here. It arbitrarily removes. Here in this problem, it has been removing the item from the rear end. That is just by chance. By chance, it is doing it. It can remove it from anywhere. So now let us go to the next thing. And that is from keys. From keys is also important function. Let us find out what is the purpose of from keys. So from keys, what it accepts? It accepts a sequence, creates a dictionary from that sequence, taking items of that sequence as keys and values being none. So let us find out what it means. So what I will do, I will write d is equal to dict dot. I can issue from key function like this also, dict dot from keys. And here I will pass a list having 4, 7, 9. Okay, now so it will give you 4:none, 7:none, and 9:none. So we're taking all these items as key value, attaching with a none values, it will create a dictionary. That's it. This is the purpose of from keys. I hope you have understood. Now let us go to the next thing, that is update function. This is very, very important function, update function. Now let us find out how many items are remaining in our dictionary. In our dictionary, what was our dictionary? D. So D, I have again, D I have created. Let us create our dictionary as D is equal to, let us copy this code, the first one. Okay. And here I will write D is equal to this one. Now, here, what I want to do is, I want to D dot update. And here, what you have to pass according to the function definition, you have to pass a sequence, and this sequence will carry each item as a tuple having two elements, exactly two elements, a key, a value. So let us do it and find out what we get. Here, if I'm going to pass here 1, like this, a list having, let us proceed. So if I'm going to write d dot update, I have issued that command d dot update 134 as the case is available on your screen. What will be the output of d? If I'm going to print d, what will be the output? It will update only one tuple, one key value, and that is one. And since one is already there, it will not add another one, and it will update that value 12 with 34, and it will give you 134 in place of 112. What will be the answer of this? If I am going to print D now, see here that the item 5 is being replaced with the key value 5 is replaced with the value 23, and you have added a new key value pair 540 with 32, isn't it? So this is how it goes. So with this, we come to the end of this built-in function dictionaries. There are total 14 or 15 dictionary functions you should remember. Now let us go to the exercise example 2, and here it is. Be ready with your copy and pen, all of you students. Two questions are there based on dictionary. Two example exercises are there. We will do it in the next session if you are not able to do it. Okay, and here is the class assignment for you, given to you to do, solve in this class, and that ends our dictionary session. There's nothing more to add on to the dictionary. With this class assignment, I want to end my class, but you should note this class assignment before switching off.